Добрый день, дорогие друзья, уважаемые коллеги. Меня зовут Борис Грозовский, я креативный директор фонда Егора Гайдара. Мне ужасно приятно представлять вам сегодняшнего лектора. Симеон Дианков – это совершенно уникальный человек с точки зрения того, как он соединяет исследовательскую работу и то, что можно назвать участием в экономической политике, как через консультирование различных правительств и реформаторских кругов в разных странах бывшего социалистического лагеря, так и через ту великолепную работу, которую Симеон проделал в начале 2000-х годов, сконструировав вместе с коллегами во Всемирном банке рэнкинг Doing Business. Очень много есть различных статей на эту тему, да, какие-то аспекты можно критиковать, но никакого другого инструмента, позволяющего с какой-то более или менее верифицированной точностью сравнивать качество делового климата в очень непохожих друг на друга странах, просто нету. Вот. Всем, кто еще не читал, я ужасно советую, может быть, после сегодняшней лекции посмотреть написанную Симеоном главу из книги «The Great Rebirth», «Великое возрождение», по-русски она будет называться. Книгу готовят сейчас к изданию на русском языке «Новое издательство» или портал inliberty.ru. И вот на этом портале опубликована глава из этой книжки, которую написал Симеон, и которая, собственно, так и называется «Великое возрождение». inliberty.ru, Симеон Дианко, «Великое возрождение». Всем, кому интересно, ссылки на некоторые другие работы Симеона я вот давал на сайте Егора Гайдара, на сайте фонда Егора Гайдара в анонсе этой лекции. Так что не буду слишком долго распространяться. Только две еще вещи. Во-первых, опять же, очень всем рекомендую совсем недавнюю работу Симеона. Ее можно найти на сайте ssrn.com, Social Science Research Network. Это безумно интересная научная статья, надеюсь, что Симеон немножечко будет о ней сегодня рассказывать, которая показывает, как правительство стран с переходной экономикой, в особенности России и Украины, в буквальном смысле слова, крадут у населения своих стран счастье. Это очень интересная вещь, как бы немножко сбоку лежащая от основной темы сегодняшней лекции, но многочисленные исследования типа мирового исследования ценностей, World Value Survey, европейского исследования ценностей, показывают, что вот жители наших стран удивительно несчастны для стран с подобным уровнем подушевых доходов и так далее. Симеон предложил объяснение, которое, насколько я понимаю, до сих пор не высказывалось с такой отчетливостью в экономике, что это связано с качеством госуправления и с распространенностью коррупции. То есть плохое качество государства в буквальном смысле слова делает людей несчастными. Это как бы очень интересная и отчасти неожиданная трактовка. Еще один штрих к к тому, что делает Симеон. Посмотрите, пожалуйста, всем, кому интересно, сайт, который называется ideas42.org. 42, те, кто читал Дугласа Адамса, знают, да, что это ответ на вопрос о смысле Вселенной и всего такого. А ideas42, группа, созданная в том числе и Симеоном, это группа экономистов, психологов, социологов, которым симпатичны развившиеся в последние лет 20 такие бихевиористские подходы в политической науке и в экономике, и которые думают о том, как сделать экономическую политику в разных странах лучше с помощью того, что можно было бы назвать таким мягким патернализмом, когда правительство пытается подталкивать организации и людей к принятию выгодных для них самих решений в том, что касается личной пенсионной политики, финансовой политики и так далее. Вещь, опять же, достаточно спорная, ей посвящены множество интересных научных работ. Я надеюсь, что мы еще на каких-нибудь дискуссиях Гайдар-клуба об этом сможем поговорить. Это Карл Санстейн, да, и так далее, и так далее. Очень интересная научная традиция, которая в России пока почти неизвестна. Вот, кажется, я о Симеоне сказал достаточно и готов передать ему микрофон.
Спасибо. Добрый вечер. Я лекцию по английскому языку буду говорить, потому что мне это будет быстрее, а потом дискуссии можно на русском языке. When we met with Boris and discussed this lecture, actually it was in Kiev, a strange place to discuss transition, since Ukraine is probably the only country in the whole transition of post-Soviet, post-communist region that I have argued in my studies has never actually gone through transition. Basically nothing happened for 26 years. But at that meeting we discussed what are some commonalities across all the countries, not just the post-Soviet countries that we'll discuss mostly tonight, but also some of the countries of Eastern Europe, which I know better coming from there, having worked quite a bit there. So what I thought I'll do is start with some comments about all of the post-communist countries, and then towards the end of my talk specifically about the four countries listed here, and of course Russia more specifically, which probably is most interesting for you. 25 years ago when transition started, first in Eastern Europe, for a period of time there were in academia, at universities, the main discussion was how quickly to do reforms, transition, both political transition as well as economic transition. So how to make the first step, the second step, what should be the different steps, looking at the history of previous such transitions. And while academics were discussing this topic, several countries, Poland first under Leszek Balcerowicz, then the Czech Republic under Václav Klaus basically did their reforms, so they didn't wait for any academics or foreign advisors for that matter to tell them what to do. These two countries in 1990, 1991, 1992, the first 2-3 years of transition, basically had done the majority of steps that any other country in our region would take later on. I know both Leszek Balcerowicz and Václav Klaus quite well. We've written together, we've been to various conferences together. And I've asked them many times, why did you go this way? So why didn't you listen to anybody, basically, but just went straight and did these types of reforms? And both of them say roughly the same thing, which is that there was a great expectation in our societies, in the Polish society, the Czechoslovak society at the time, that transition needs to be very quick and needs to be very definitive. Otherwise, people will be unhappy. People are already unhappy with this regime, so unless we move very fast to a new regime, there will be great unhappiness. So basically, we move very fast because this is what people wanted. And indeed, in these countries, in a matter of 3-4 years, all the major liberalization of political life, liberalization of economic life, opening of international trade, privatization, liberalization of internal prices, basically all of this happened very quickly. Most other countries hesitated. The next two countries actually that started the reform were Estonia and Russia, interestingly. Now, many years later, typically when you talk about Russia, people generally say this is an example of a country that didn't reform. But actually, very early on in the transition, in the early and mid-90s, Russia was one of the main examples of reformist countries. The problem, as we discussed later, is that it just got stuck there, so it never went forward, and then later on it actually reversed. So at the end of my talk, I'll talk about reversals. Poland, the Czech Republic, following another year, year and a half, Estonia, Russia, these were the early examples of reformers that constitute one group. There was a second group where most of the post-communist countries belong, basically countries that knew that they need to go this way, politically had chosen to go the way of reform, post-communist reform, but were not sure at what speed to go, so they hesitated. And there are countries like Slovakia, for example, that took a long time to figure out what they want to do. Countries like Bulgaria, my own country. Hungary, even, that took until about 1996, so 6 years into the transition process, to actually start serious economic changes. And the majority of countries, except for Russia and Estonia in the former Soviet Union. Basically, there was a wait to see which way to go, particularly on the topic of privatization and liberalization of prices, because many politicians felt, rightly so, that whoever privatizes generally is hated and despised by the population, so they would not have a very long political life. That's incidentally proven not to be the case, at least not in cases like Václav Klaus and some other reformers later on, but that was the common wisdom, that if you privatize, basically you leave politics soon after that and basically never show up again. So the majority of countries in our region belong to this group, so they waited a few years, but then still slower than the first reformers went this way of both political liberalization, democracy in other words, and economic reform. And then there was a third group of countries, of which Belarus and Kazakhstan belong, not many countries, maybe 7 or so countries, with one exception, all in the former Soviet Union. Kazakhstan, Tajikistan, Turkmenistan, Azerbaijan, Georgia was actually early on in this group, Belarus, that basically didn't want to reform, said, no, we don't, this is too dangerous. The population basically wants stability. We want political stability and we want economic stability. And rather than going the path of both political and economic reform, we're basically going to try to, in some form, keep stability by maybe not having communists, but renaming communists into something else, and then having the same people, basically the same elites around the countries, and thinking about economic reforms, but actually never doing them, even to date. So countries like Kazakhstan and Belarus are among the few countries in this group. There were several such countries in Central Europe as well. For a brief period of time, Slovakia was a country like that, that after the initial period of transition after Václav Klaus, it split into the Czech and Slovak republics. The Slovak Republic elected a communist, Mečiar, who actually ran until 1998 for another 5 years or so. Basically, Slovakia was completely outside of any economic or political, for that matter, liberalization. But in 1998, it rapidly took the path of a fast reform, and in fact, by now, Slovakia is further ahead than countries like the Czech Republic, Poland, even in many respects. And actually, income per capita in Slovakia is higher now, both relative to Polish income per capita as well as relative to income per capita in the Czech Republic. But three groups of countries: early reformers, not many; everybody who waited but basically had chosen the path of reform; and the third group, basically, who didn't want to reform, wanted to keep the old system under new guise. Same guys with different party affiliation, or in some cases no party affiliation whatsoever, win elections year after year and keep both the economic and the political status quo. So if we go 20, 27 years into the future, so to nowadays, what can we observe among these three groups of countries? Well, the early reformers who went all the way, so Poland, the Czech Republic, Estonia, are doing very well. Their income per capita has risen dramatically, 2, 3, 4 times in the case of Slovakia in the last 15 or so years. And you can say that now they're normal, relatively boring in some sense, European countries. So they've reached a level of income and also political democracy, which is the same as in the rest of Central and Western Europe. Russia is a separate case, I'll talk about it later, but basically it looked like it's going this way until about 96, 97, and then it reversed. And we are where we are today. We'll spend more time on that. The second group of countries is, to me, most interesting, and I'll show you also some slides on happiness, because these are the countries that did the reforms, or at least the majority of reforms, both political and economic, did them a bit late, and as a result of this lateness, which in most cases was purposeful, it's not that they wanted really just to think it through, but there was a purposeful delay by the political elites of the time, mostly communist elites or post-communist elites, until they figure out how to distribute, how to behave as new capitalists, basically. So in all of these countries what happened, I think Ukraine is a great case in point, is that basically the old communist elite figured out how to become a capitalist elite, took a few years to do this. And once the reform process started, liberalization of prices, privatization and so on, they got everything for themselves. So basically, it's the same elite, except now they're richer than they were before. And that elite keeps itself in power, including in countries that have elections. So it's not just non-democratic countries, purely non-democratic countries, but actually you have a formal election process, but basically the same guys are in power. What's important for this delayed reforms, and I'll show you some slides in a minute, is that because of the delay, the former elites managed to organize themselves in economic ways as well, and basically took over privatized industry. So now you have them both politically strong as well as economically strong. There are many countries in point, including to some extent my own country, Bulgaria. But again, if you look at Ukraine and you look president after president in Ukraine and what they own, both formally and informally, what their families own, what economic groups stand behind them, you would see that these basically are people who are billionaires in different ways. Hidden or semi-hidden and so on, but they used, and not just the top people, everybody in politics, by and large, used their political appointments to enrich themselves. To some extent, this happened in other countries as well, which determines, in my mind, the follow-up of reforms, which is that people said, well, if this is the reform that we were going to basically suffer because of, well, we don't want it. So we want stability, we want to stop this type of reforms that essentially incur pain on us, the majority of the population. And in the end, you have the same structure of the elites in our countries, except that they're much more well-to-do, much richer than we are. So this is mostly consistent with the second group. To some extent, that happened in the reversal in Russia as well, that once reform stopped, there was an attempt to basically do reforms a different way, do privatization a different way, as you know, in 1995-96. The result of that was that political elites and people around them got extremely rich, more so than in other countries, given the natural resources that that Russia has. And the idea of reform, of transformation, of economic and political change to some extent, basically got corrupted. So what happened in these countries, in one word, corruption. Everything became very corrupt. The idea of change, of reform, was associated in the minds of people with corruption. And I'll show you a few slides in a moment. Before that, I'll just mention briefly the third group of countries, which to some extent is the least interesting, but for completeness, which is the countries that the political elite from the very beginning basically managed to convince the population better not try these silly things of democracy and economic reform, better basically stay as we are, we'll do some changes to the extent possible in the country, but they're going to be cosmetic and we'll remain as we are. There's going to be good stability and you're not going to worry about tomorrow. So countries like Belarus, like Kazakhstan, Turkmenistan, Tajikistan, to some extent Azerbaijan and even Armenia belong to this group. Well, early on in the transition, everybody was saying, wait for another year, 2 years, they will surely collapse because they don't have markets, around the economy better. So everybody was expecting already from about the late 1990s for, let's say, a country like Belarus, the economy to collapse. And it actually didn't collapse. Hasn't grown particularly, but hasn't collapsed either. And neither have some of the other countries that I mentioned yet. So it seems that collapse is a long-term process. There are different reasons for the non-collapse in some of these countries. Belarus, as you probably well know, is very much subsidized by Russia. So basically, in the absence of Russia, Belarus would have been a very, very poor country by now, but mostly through energy exports from Russia to Belarus. The economy is very heavily subsidized. So incidentally, in various ways, other economies, the economy of Tajikistan is very dependent on the Russian economy. Without it, it wouldn't have survived the way that it has, while other countries depend on natural resources. And it's not only countries in this region that, of course, depend on natural resources. There are other regions in the world, like the Middle East, that have political regimes and non-open economies, so to speak, that depend on the fact that a large share of national income is derived from oil or other natural resources. And that can continue for quite a while, as long as economic growth somehow is maintained through these extractive industries. The population, by and large, seems to be happy with this stability. So now that I've given you this very broad distinction of the three groups, I want to come rapidly to nowadays and say also what happened. So they started with three groups. Some of these remained remarkably stable. There are some countries, but very few that jumped. So Russia was a fast reformer, then it went into the basically slow reform category, and then it went into a reversal, into sort of the last group, which is no reform whatsoever. We are going to focus on stability at the expense of any positive or otherwise change. Slovakia, I mentioned, was a country that was a very late reformer, but managed actually in about 2003, 2004, 2005, just in 3 years, it managed to do the type of reforms to jump over the Czech Republic, Poland, Hungary, and become both richer and more reformed country. And there are some other attempts at jumping, like Georgia, for example, a country that was deeply, deeply corrupt as Ukraine, and as driven by the old elites, as Ukraine has been for a long time. They attempted a change in 2003, 2004. For a few years, they were going very fast ahead in economic reforms, certainly. And then sort of they slowed down, there was some reversal recently, so it's a case where a country changed significantly from a very corrupt, sorry, economic state, but now in recent years has gone backwards, at least on some of the more fundamental reforms. So with all of this, one can ask, one would expect that there would be some correlation between countries that have reformed fast, countries that have trying to reform, and countries that have not reformed at all in terms of happiness. So are people now happy with the process that they have gone through? On average, you'd expect that there should be some link between how fast you move and how richer you become as part of these reforms, how much politically freer you also become. Or not. So this is the research that was mentioned earlier. I'll just show you part of it. It's on the website, as was mentioned, so I'm skipping all the text of it to get to the point. So in this research, we do something very simple. We say, well, the majority of transition economies or countries, rather, exist in the same surveys that Western Europe, most of the middle-income and developed countries belong, which are value surveys. In this type of surveys, it was mentioned, there is a world survey every 2 years, there is a European survey every year. There is a survey done by the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development specifically for transition economies and a few other European countries, which is done every 3 years. Among many other questions, there are a number of questions that ask people, basically, are you happy with your life? And then, if you're not happy with your life, they ask a number of other questions, roughly why you're not happy. Well, those who do social science, not just economics, know that there are some determinants, we've uncovered some determinants of happiness or unhappiness. So generally, people are happy when they're healthy. This is the number one determinant of happiness. If you're happy, if you're healthy, your happiness with life is greatly improved. Number two, income. So if you're rich, you're generally happier than if you're poor. Number three, most of you in a day like this would appreciate, number of sunny days. So if you have more sun around, you're generally happier than if it is always cloudy or rainy and so on. Number four, these are studies, I'm just enumerating studies that have been done before us that look at the motivation for people being happy world around. So health, income, sun. The sun, number four, basically family. This is a bit shaky in terms of research grounds, but basically if you have people around you, family around you to share life with, difficult or not difficult, basically you're happy as well. So these are the four main determinants of happiness. So if that's the case, then you can ask the question, well, let's see whether our countries are normal countries in the sense that in our post-communist countries, these four determinants also matter. So, or whether we post-communist people are just strange people. So we are not guided by this type of basic happiness indicators, and we are guided by something else. So at the beginning of the study, we just asked this question: is Eastern Europe and the post-Soviet Union countries the same as the rest of the world in terms of determinants of happiness? And the answer to that, fortunately, is yes. So if you take a Bulgarian, a Russian, a Czech, and so on, and then you do this type of regressions or economic statistics that I mentioned, generally we're driven by the same indicators that other people. So the basic theories work. Then we ask a second question, and I'll show you some slides on this. We say, well, then it should be the case that in countries in Eastern Europe and the former Soviet Union that have rapidly gotten richer with time, in transition I mean, and countries where there is more sun, like Bulgaria, and countries that people are healthier and so on, they should have by now, after 27 years, they should have reached some normal average level of happiness. I don't know what normal level is in Europe, but let's say like the Austrians. You know, they're reasonably rich, reasonably happy, not too much sun, but some sun, basically some average level of European happiness. So what we do is that we run regressions. This is one example for 2014, where we take every country in Europe, and then we run essentially happiness on income per capita, but also controlling for the number of sunny days in the year, health, basically how much your life expectancy is, which is one basic measure of health. We've tried some others, and basically some attributes of family to adjust for every country. So if the basic theory of happiness is right, you should expect every country to be on this orange or yellow line, roughly speaking. Or just above it, actually, since there are some outliers. So what you see from this first graph, and what we show here are not just the countries where the names are seen, like Russia, Poland, Ukraine. The very bottom one is Moldova, incidentally, that real outlier of happiness on this graph. But we also have shown you in blue, as opposed to brown, let's say, or black, some of the other transition economies like Belarus, like Kazakhstan, like Georgia. They haven't shown here on this slide as names. So what you see from here, and you'll see in several other graphs, is that basically our transition countries, controlling for all these other characteristics, are not happy as much as they should be, to put it one way. They're consistently below the line of average happiness. And I'll show you the line, which is year by year for the last 10 years. And not just for Europe, but for every middle income and rich country in the world. So basically the blue ones are what we compare with. So this would be the Austrians, the Chiles, the Malaysians, and so on. And yellow lines are our countries. So there are some of them that are above the line, but the vast majority of our countries, in different years of course, are consistently below the line, so less happy than the basic economic and social statistics would suggest. Let me see whether I have the particular one on. Sorry. I had one which was showing specifically where Russia and Ukraine are. So controlling for income, controlling for health, controlling for weather, and controlling for family. The least happy country in the world, let's put it that way, is Ukraine. So there is no unhappier country in the world than Ukraine, if you control for everything else. Which, and this I should note, is consistently from the data go 15 years back, so it's not a recent phenomenon. This is a phenomenon that goes consistently from the late 90s, when data are available, every year to 2014. Second unhappiest country in the world, you probably would have guessed by now, Russia. So Russia is the second unhappiest country in the world. But then there is a break, so there is one African country that is number three, and then it's followed by Serbia, Belarus, Bulgaria as unhappiest countries in the world, controlling for all other characteristics, and notice Hungary. So we so far have spoken about countries mostly from the post-Soviet Union, but let me note that while Ukraine and Russia certainly hold records in this regard, there are also some relatively well-to-do countries like Hungary that on these indicators are real outliers. Very unhappy given their characteristics. The paper has a lot more pictures. I'll finish with this picture for now and return to the main topic to say early on in the lecture, studies like this done 10, 12 years ago, done 5 years ago by other researchers, not by us, including one very nice study done in 2007 also by Katia Zhuravskaya, formerly of the New Economic School, now a professor in Paris, but basically found exactly the same as we did, exactly the same unhappiness gap, or happiness gap as we call it. But at the time, 5 years ago, basically she in her paper optimistically noted that this exists, but probably as more years go and people realize the achievements, let's say, that their countries have had in the transition period, they'll get happier, basically. So this gap is there, but it will disappear over time. So what this tries to show, putting together all transition economies, so post-communist countries in red and the rest of the countries in the world, that there was a period in which the gap indeed was starting to shorten. Especially between 2000 and somewhere around 2006-2007. But then after that, it's remained remarkably stable. So we are not getting, we're not converging, in other words. This is very easy work, very simple to replicate. Other people have done it since. It's not particularly original either, but it begs the question, so what's happening? Why are we in our region not getting happier? And also related to the discussion that we've had so far tonight. I'm getting ahead. Why is that happening? And is there some difference across countries? And roughly speaking, what is happening is, as I mentioned, the whole region is still depressed relative to other regions in the world. But in a particularly bad shape are countries like Russia, like Bulgaria, like Hungary to some extent, like Georgia, like Armenia. They did some reform early on. It didn't work, or at least there was a perception that these reforms were not sufficient or were too stark, too painful, and politically they were not ready to be supported into the future. Basically, reforms stopped. So the countries in the second group of the three groups that I described, not the fast reformers, not the non-reformers, the ones that never tried, but the countries in the middle, which are the majority of post-communist countries that tried something, but tried it slow, tried it when it was perhaps somewhat late, tried it when the elite already had captured the economic sector as well. These are the countries that are particularly unhappy. Why then that is the case? Once you know that answer, you can start constructing the answer to that question. And for that, we went to the other survey questions, basically trying to link what are the characteristics of the countries in which people say that they're particularly unhappy. And not to go through the whole paper, essentially what comes out is that in the minds of people, especially in this slow reform countries or countries which started reform and then reversed, they see the transition process almost universally as a process of basically increasing corruption. So some people are getting rich, getting positions into the government or around the government, getting rich in the process, leaving sometimes the government and just becoming business people, rich people, or staying in the government in other countries and continuing to enrich themselves. Again, Ukraine is a great example of that. And the average part of the population is clearly becoming less and less happy with the transition process because they think that the transition process is essentially about a small group of politicians, essentially, enriching themselves. It's about corruption. And hence, in these surveys, year after year, you get this link between, within the regressions, it would be. So this just shows that the transition economies are less satisfied controlling for various things than other countries. Then there are some results I'll show quickly, basically on government effectiveness. In others, we also have corruption. Corruption indices that give this story. So as the years go by, more and more people in this majority of transition economies associate transition basically with corruption. And the corruption of a particular group of political economic elite. Well, if transition is about corruption in the minds of the majority of people, no wonder that they want something different from transition. And since transition, by definition, was defined early on as change, basically transformation of the previous regime to some new regime, more and more we see, both in surveys as well as in the actual political developments around the region, basically conservatism, going away from change, from transformation, and making the point, well, actually, change is not always good. In fact, stability is preferred to change. So let's look and support politicians or political parties or economic platforms that basically don't go for change, broadly speaking, but go for stability. What does that mean, go for stability? Well, it means at one end of more democratic countries, basically parties that are so-called law and order parties. So they say, well, privatization was a very bad idea. Economic reform generally could be good, but could be bad. But if we come to power, we promise you basically to beat all the rich people and put them in prison, and basically to beat everybody who doesn't behave as we expect them to behave, roughly speaking. And there are a number of such parties, so the Law and Order Party in Poland has been quite active over the last 10 years, twice in government, probably will come to government again very soon. The rise over the last 6-7 years in Slovakia of the current Prime Minister and his Robert Fico and his party, which is basically a Law and Order Party. And by that I mean that they are focusing on traditional national values, so these are roughly nationalist parties, who, however, focus on traditional values, on stability, not on reform, on going forward. So a number of parties in democratic Central East European countries. The two countries, of course, that most of the world watches intently and tries to understand what is happening are Russia and Hungary, to different degrees, of course, the countries. One is a lot more significant in the world than the other. But in both of these countries, in the early to mid-90s, we saw substantial economic reforms. You could say that they were in the first group of reformer countries. Both of them then stopped, had a period of crony capitalism, as it has come to be called. And in about the last 10 years in Russia, and a bit less than 10 years in the case of Hungary, we have a political regime and an economic regime that is focusing on stability, on conservatism, on, as Viktor Orban, the Prime Minister of Hungary, recently called it, on illiberal democracy, which is that we're not really liberal, we're not quite a democracy, he says, so we're illiberal, but we still have parties, so we call ourselves illiberal democracies. Who are looking for an economic model that is not like the communist model of the past, is not like the free market model that we thought all that we were going to reach at some point, but is some new economic model that we're yet to see what it is. But we have some characteristics of it, and they are prevalent both in the Russian economy today, and they are less prevalent, but going in that direction, in the Hungarian economy. I'll name just a few of these characteristics. The first characteristic is a return to state ownership. So if you compare, I've done in a recent paper, the share of state ownership in the economy today in Russia, it's actually higher than 20 years ago in 1995, both in terms of the percentage of workers who work for state-owned companies and municipal companies, in general companies related to the state, and in terms of share of the most significant industries, finance, energy, transport, natural resources, more generally. If you look in 1995-96, what the share of private ownership was, and compare it to nowadays, in 1995 it was higher than today. The same incidentally is true in Hungary. It's less known of a case, but Hungary has also renationalized or nationalized some particularly energy and transport assets in the last 6-7 years since Viktor Orban has been in power. So, but number one, not surprising, perhaps, a return to conservatism, a return to national values, basically nationalization, or larger role of the state. Number two, and that this a lot more prevalent in Russia than in other countries, is an attempt to basically avoid altogether the market. So not only through ownership, for larger state ownership, but even where private markets exist, to say, well, we don't like prices to be somehow set on a global stage, on a regional stage, on sectoral stage. We like somehow to be able to control prices. How does this happen? Basically through monopolization or oligopolization. You have very few actors in any given sector. And then, you know, if you have three or four firms, let's say in a sector like transport or like aviation is a good, airlines is a good recent example, but there are many other examples in Russia, then prices to some extent are those that the larger players tell you that they will be. And this is happening more and more in Russia, which incidentally has been happening for all these years in some of the other countries that never attempted reform, like Belarus, like Kazakhstan, Turkmenistan, and so on. Now, some look at this and say, well, this is just specific political leaders, so that if the political leader has this particular view, so this is what happens. And the point of this research is that actually it's not particular political leaders, it's that the majority of the population in these countries actually, unlike perhaps in the past, wants a different system, wants a more stable system, a system that somehow depends more on their own government and not on some other external market forces that are relatively unknown to them. They cannot imagine themselves operating. So it's, and moreover, it's not just a trend that somehow Russia trend or Hungary trend, or I mentioned Slovakia, it's a trend that in various, of course, to various degrees, is actually prevalent now in the whole region. So you can see even in fast reforming in the past countries like Poland, like Slovakia, like the Czech Republic, that particular parts of what was thought to be very significant reforms, like pension system reform, privatizing parts of the pension system, now has been reversed. So in Slovakia, in Poland, in Hungary, of course, in Romania to some extent, in Bulgaria to some extent, in the last 3 or 4 years, what used to be a mostly private pension system for 10, 12 years has actually reversed back to a mostly state-owned pension system. So there is, in other words, a trend in our region of people saying, well, market forces are fine, but we generally prefer more stability, and this to us is given by the state. So I want to finish the talk by generally talking a bit about stability. Where does stability come from? Real stability as well as perceived stability. Well, one way to get stability, economic stability I mean, this is to become part of a bigger bloc, basically to say, well, our economy is small, or even if it's not small like the Russian economy, some sectors is developed, some sectors is not developed. So if we become part of a bigger economic bloc, that should give us more stability, and incidentally, it should give us more growth. So different countries in the region have oriented themselves towards larger economic blocs. In Central and Eastern Europe, this was perhaps easiest and most natural, towards the European Union. Why? Because these are another 350 nearly million consumers, million people. Linking with them, linking your economy with the European Union gives you a lot of possibilities for growth, for infrastructure development, basically being part of a bigger market. So that's why many countries of our region, of Central and Eastern Europe, regardless of the political left of center, right of center, every political party in the past and even now, generally speaking, has European integration as one of the main policy choices. Basically because it gives stability. The population of the country thinks of integration as giving you an extra sense of both economic but as well as political stability. In and around Russia, there is a similar concept, less developed of course, which is the Eurasian Economic Union. So if you think about why countries like Kazakhstan, like the Kyrgyz Republic, like Armenia, would actually consider the Eurasian Economic Union, well, there are several other reasons, but the main reason basically is that it provides a larger market for their goods and services, provides more stability than they currently have. And even going beyond that, a trend that in the last maybe 1.5 years has become quite significant, especially in Central Asia, now more in Russia, in some parts of Eastern Europe, is this, let's say, China-led initiative called the New Silk Road. Some of you may have heard of this, which is the idea of having a large Eurasian, I wouldn't call it union, but economic space that starts from China, goes through Kazakhstan, Russia, Belarus, Central Europe, and goes all the way to Germany. So even Germany is excited about this idea, where through rapidly building infrastructure, through Kazakhstan, through Turkmenistan, through this part of Russia that is closest to the Kazakh border, and then from there to Kazan, Moscow, St. Petersburg, going down towards the ports of Hamburg, Rotterdam, and so on, basically to create a new large economic zone that would create economic stability. And this idea is very excited for many, many politicians, some in Russia, increasingly so, but certainly if you visited Kazakhstan or Georgia or the Kyrgyz Republic or some of the former Yugoslav republics not part of the European Union yet, this is the prevalent economic idea now, becoming part of this new concept of the Silk Road that gives infrastructural development and with it the hope of larger trade, larger economic development. So I'll just say a few parting words on economic and to some extent political stability. When we started transition, we thought that it's a relatively monotonic process going through democracy, going through free markets, basically becoming normal European countries, or normal countries like some that we imagined and maybe some of us had seen. Three, maybe four countries of all of the nearly 30 post-communist countries managed to do this. Czech Republic, I mentioned, Poland, Estonia. That's about it, Slovakia maybe. Everybody else actually hasn't gone there yet. Maybe they will at some point, I think they will, but certainly it has been a much slower process. And during this this period, several things, significant things occurred. I mentioned two of them. One is that the transition process itself was associated more and more with corruption, and hence there was more and more pressure against it, against further reform. And four, maybe not a return to what was before, but a return to some nationalist, local, traditional, conservative political and economic model. But for small countries, this is not enough. So they need some extra level of stability. And they found it, as I are trying to find it, as I'm trying to argue, in integration into a larger group, be it the European Union, the Eurasian Economic Union, maybe this new idea of the new Silk Road. The third thing, and I'll finish with this, which makes progress or trying to understand of where our countries are going to go next, is the fact that in the past, when we started the transition, we thought that there was a functioning, certainly economic model in Europe, or at least some European countries like Ireland, like Germany, like Spain, certainly we thought in the early 1990s and mid-1990s. And if we tried hard, we'll get there eventually. So this is the economic models that we followed. But while some of the transition process was being derailed in our countries and corruption was becoming a bigger and bigger issue, something else was also happening, which was helping in some sense this return to traditional values, conservatism, stability cause. Namely, that we suddenly all saw that the European economic model is not working. And we entered the Eurozone crisis. We saw a number of countries that we as economists, were pointing out as the best economic models, like the Irish Tiger, like the Spanish Great Development example, basically went into significant crisis. And it turned out that they're not actually as successful as we thought. Why am I saying this? Because I've had a number of discussions over the past few years with, let's say, with Prime Minister Orban, to try and understand how does he think about the path that he is taking Hungary. And he ultimately gets to this point, which is that, well, early on we were naive, we were young, and we thought that we would become like Europe. But do we now want to become like Europe? Do we now want to be like Spain? Do we want to be like Greece? Do we want to be like Ireland? Like France? Like Italy? Well, no, we are not really sure. Maybe at some point we would want again, but certainly now these countries don't seem to be giving us the right economic model. So think where politicians stand. They're in a difficult position. Sometimes you have to be sorry for politicians. So to the West are countries, with very few exceptions, maybe Germany lately, that are not great examples as economic models. You wouldn't want to be like them. Well, 5 years ago you would say, but we want to be like China, because China is growing very fast and, you know, it has this state control model of development. Maybe we want to be like China. But if you look at China today, it's not actually a good model. The economy is starting to slow very significantly, and it will be slowing down and slowing down in the next few years. How do I know this? Not that I know much about the Chinese economy, but because we've had this before. In the 60s, we all thought that the Japanese economy is the best economy in the world, and the Japanese are going to take over the world. They didn't. They got to a certain level in the 80s, and since then, the economy has hardly grown. Then we thought that Korea would be the next biggest economy in terms of economic growth in the world, and Korea has done well. But it certainly hasn't taken the world. It grew up to a point of a middle-income country and basically stopped growing very fast. Now China is a country that for a long time grew very fast. Well, it's not going to grow very fast anymore. So if you're a policymaker, you look to the West, basically Europe is not doing great. You look to the East, they're not doing that great either. Better certainly than Europe, but not that great. Well, which economic model are you going to use? In my mind, this is one of the reasons, the lack of alternatives, let's say, that countries like Russia, to some extent countries like Hungary, in a situation where if nothing else is obviously working well, maybe we should go back to our traditional values and stay there for some time at least, until some new economic model and maybe political model alongside it develops. I don't know which economic model that would be. If I knew, this would be a very exciting lecture. But what I'm convinced in, other than the trends that I mentioned in this lecture that one very important thing to look for is precisely this. Where in Europe or where in Asia or maybe in other parts of the world, somewhere there is a model, a country, it has to be a reasonable size country, cannot be tiny, where the economy seems to be operating quite well and is consistently operating quite well. And can we learn from that? Perhaps that is going to give us the next phase of transition in our region, and perhaps in that phase we're going to reach this level of normal European countries, which are going to be somewhat richer, somewhat happier, somewhat more boring perhaps, but we would all feel like we are normal people and we belong in a normal country, which is not the case now. Thank you.
Спасибо огромное, Семен, за прекрасную лекцию. А если можно, такой вот вопрос на первый на правах ведущего. Вот в этой самой статье вместе с Ослундом «Великое возрождение» у вас есть такой тезис, что реформировать государство для постсоциалистических стран оказалось намного сложнее, чем реформировать экономику. Почему это оказалось так? Почему этого не было видно в самом начале перехода, в первой половине 90-х годов? Сложность реформирования государства, она, мне кажется, мало кем из транзитных, переходных экономик осознавалась. И, собственно, от чего зависит, кому проще, а кому сложнее реформировать государство?
Indeed, at the beginning of the transition process, I was at the World Bank, I should say, for a very long time, and before doing business, I was, as one of the few people who knew Russian, at the time my Russian was better than now, I was sent to every conceivable post-communist country to try and help them with enterprise restructuring, privatization, banking reform, every crazy idea that the World Bank and the International Monetary Fund came up with, I was part of this this delegation, so I went through this transition process myself. And early on it was indeed thought that the most difficult part of transition would be privatization, basically because you have, especially in a country like Russia, where you have hundreds of thousands of enterprises that had operated for a very long time in state ownership, suddenly you'd have to change their ownership. Their management would have to be changed or somehow adjust to a new economic environment. Prices would have to adjust, and in all of this, it would be very, very difficult to change the mentality of the industry. And actually, it wasn't. I mentioned that in Poland, in the Czech Republic, it happened basically in 1 or 2 years. Privatized everything. There were problems, of course, later on. But the privatization process itself was remarkably fast and, if done early on, was not particularly politically difficult. Both Balcerovic and Klaus remained in power, or returned to power in the case of Leszek Balcerovic. So what we thought would be difficult turned out not to be so difficult, as you mentioned. We conversely thought that it should be relatively easy to change the state, or some of the state agencies, the way that the state operates, institutions. Why did we think so? Well, because we know functioning institutions elsewhere. So while there was never in history such a large privatization wave, let's say that in Russia, if you look at Margaret Thatcher, for example, that everybody was looking to for big privatizing campaign in the 80s, she privatized 11 companies. In all of her 10 years in power, she privatized 11 companies. While here, there were literally 700,000-800,000 companies in Russia privatized just in the early 90s, so a lot more. But then we could see how in other countries, in Germany, in Ireland, in Chile, particularly in Latin America, that the transformation, the political transformation, happened a bit earlier than ours, just a few years earlier than ours. We were seeing how countries like Chile actually developed reasonably functioning state institutions in several years. So I think there was this pension reform, for example, pension institutions, judicial reform. So I think we very naively thought that basically if Chile did it, so should everybody else in our region as well. And that proved to be certainly not true. Even now, not even speaking about Russia, how inefficient and corrupt the judiciary in Russia is. The same is true in Bulgaria. The same is true, by and large, in countries like Slovakia and the Czech Republic. Less so, but it's still very far from what we thought it would be. So we had a good example, but somehow it didn't work in our countries. Why is that the case? I think there are two answers to this. One that we realize with this research is that it's not enough to change the agency or the law or the institution itself. What's more important is to change the attitude of the people who are in the agency or in the institution and the people who use it, so the customers of this institution. And somehow that way of thinking about what our institutions are for, so what's the purpose of our institution, that thinking hasn't changed yet. Not in Russia, not in Ukraine, not in Bulgaria, not in most of our countries. So what do I mean by this? People in our countries expect when they go to the courts that they will be slow, that they will be inefficient, and they will be corrupt. So this is your expectation, and if this is your expectation, if the judges expect that, you would expect them to be like this, well, it is like that. So somehow the institutions themselves, legally at least, have largely been changed in the majority of the countries. But the people, and not that they're the same people change, but somehow our expectations of how these institutions would be hasn't changed. Then I returned to Chile. So how come that in Chile it worked and in our countries it didn't work? Well, first, Chile was never for so long under a different way of thinking, communist or socialist thinking. So I think that explains a large part of it. And the other part, which I also mentioned, is that Chile, a bit like Poland and to some extent Estonia, when they reformed, they were going from basically Pinochet autocracy. They knew that they had a very short period of time to do things. So literally in a year to a year and a half, they did everything. So they changed every possible institution, fired everybody who was in the courts, fired everybody who was in customs, installed completely new people. And in this brief period, somehow they managed to change the mindset of people that these are new institutions with new people would be operating in a new way. In our countries, with very few exceptions, we never managed to do this. So this rapid change never happened. You have the same people you've seen before. You expect them to behave the same way. They expect you to behave the same way. So it's not economics. It's more about the sociology of transformation. And I think we all failed, academics and policymakers, with very few exceptions, we fail to understand how important it is to do it quickly and to do it in a very ferocious manner, just change everything now.
Спасибо. Спасибо большое. В течение вот двух с лишним лет, что Симеон работает в Москве, он, к сожалению, так редко появлялся на публике, да, чаще на разных научных мероприятиях, что я думаю, что он должен быть готов к тому, что есть желание что-то спросить не только по непосредственно теме сегодняшней лекции, не только по 25-летию прошедших реформ, но и что-то о будущем и о судьбе экономической науки в России и так далее. Можете поднять руки, чтобы я сориентировался, сколько у нас желающих. Ага. Давайте я тогда начну вот как-то так двигаться. Представляйтесь только, пожалуйста.
Национальный исследовательский центр, Кучерский институт. У меня вопрос касается, вот насколько эти показатели, которые вы обсуждали, ну, собственно, счастье, насколько они достоверны. Ведь если взять замечательный пример реформ Эстонии, то, скажем, население Эстонии за 25 лет сократилось на 25%. То есть, если вот так спрогнозировать линейно, через 30 лет в Эстонии будут все счастливы, но Эстония будет не населена никем. Вот насколько такой показатель эффективен, валиден, там, как-то?
Should I answer one by one, or should we collect? Maybe answer one by one, or collect by two of them.
As you want.
Okay, maybe try to quickly answer, and then if there are commonalities. So Estonia is also not happy. So this is, I'm not saying that the Estonians are happy. Controlling for how rich they are, those who remain in Estonia even now, and how healthy they are, and so on, they are very unhappy. So our whole region is very unhappy. So it turns out that the whole transition process that we thought will make us free and happy and so on has made us in some ways freer. We can travel, for example, a lot more than we did before. And as you said, many Estonians chose to travel and stay. But certainly hasn't made us happier. So Estonians on average are happier than Russians and Ukrainians, but they're still very far from where they should be. Our whole region psychologically hasn't finished the transition or hasn't started the transition. I don't know at which end of it we are. So we are all very unhappy. But among this unhappiness, the least happy countries or people are in those countries like Ukraine, where they didn't do reforms, but they didn't just stay stable either. So they tried different things, pretended to do reforms, so there was motion, but there was no either forward movement or stability. And people just, I think, got tired of it. Just, you know, nothing is happening, and in the meantime, we see our politicians getting richer and richer. And these are the least happy countries. But overall, I think this is why this research is interesting. I think if somebody told me Ukrainians are unhappy or Bulgarians are unhappy, I would have said, yes, I can subscribe to that. But that our whole region is unhappy, I think that's what needs to be explained. And I don't have the answer to that. That's why we call it the gap. Nobody can explain it with reasonable economic or social factors. So in that regard, I think you're right. Estonia also is not a happy country as it should be.
Большое спасибо за вашу лекцию. Евразийская экономическая комиссия. Вы сегодня упомянули о Евразийском экономическом союзе. И у меня вопрос такой. В своей презентации вы разделили страны на три категории. И вот в частности, Казахстан попал в категорию стран, которые не проводили реформ или находятся где-то, вот, раздумывая, проводить их или не проводить. Вот, ну, не совсем соглашусь, наверное, с этим, потому что, ну, значительные преобразования в экономике, по крайней мере, делаются попытки это делать. И вот если взять как один из показателей успешности проведения этих реформ, вот тот же рейтинг Doing Business, о котором вы говорили, к которому непосредственное отношение имеете, то последние годы страны, вот, в частности Евразийского экономического союза, Казахстан и Беларусь, они значительно продвинулись в этом рейтинге. Если как бы брать как показатели реформ, как индикатор реформ, вот этот рейтинг, вот. Вот как вы объясните все-таки, что вы их категоризируете как не стремящихся к проведению реформ, но в то же время прогресс вот в этом рейтинге? То есть вот, такие противоречивые, да, немножко.
No, so I should, perhaps I should be a bit more detailed in my description. So I don't mean to say that such countries like Kazakhstan in particular, Belarus also has improved in the ratings, but in a very particular way. have not done any reform. I didn't, perhaps I went too far in saying that. Every country in transition has made progress in making business friendlier, let's say. And some private sector exists in every country. Even in Belarus, there is some private sector. Even in Turkmenistan, there is some private sector. In Kazakhstan, a lot more than either in Belarus or in Turkmenistan. But early on, when the transition was starting, this is what I was referring to, there were clear delineations. So some countries will try very quickly, and even if they failed, they'll try again. Some countries hesitated. Bulgaria is also a case like that. We only started reforming through in 1997, 1998, so 7-8 years after the transition started. I think in countries like Kazakhstan, the reforms indeed now are happening. In the last few, I would say not just 2-3, maybe in the last 5 years. And you see improvements in the business environment that you mentioned. You see, at least I've been part of some work to see reforming the banking sector, the commercial banking sector, and using modern financial instruments and so on, and that is happening. But that happens after 10, 15 years of a period where these countries were, let's say, weighing their options, waiting to see which model to choose. In the meantime, as I finish my lecture with, the models around the world were not particularly particularly stable, so by the time that some of these countries started choosing a model, there was no strong economic model in Europe. Perhaps China is still a model to follow, although my own view is that in 5 years from now, we would not think of China as a good economic, or at least not as a model to follow. And we would think of other ways to develop our economies. I think in that regard, Kazakhstan is trying both some, let's say, more traditional ways to reform, like business environment reforms of the type that you mentioned are captured in doing business, but also have a way to mix, let's say, Asian economic paths, like Korea, like China, with some more traditional, let's say, European economic paths. But at least in my mind, you may know more than I do, this is a relatively recent phenomenon in the last few years. There was a period in which things were, let's say, more stable. The focus was more on stability rather than on transformation, but there are differences. For example, I've been involved in pension reform in Kazakhstan, which was happening earlier than including in some of the East European countries devising a private part of the pension system. So perhaps I should be more careful in defining countries.
Спасибо.
Михаил Александрович, вот вы говорите об экономическом, что мешает экономическому развитию. Для этого нужны реформы, да? Для реформы нужны реформаторы. Нарисуйте, пожалуйста, портрет реформатора или команды реформаторов для всех вот указанных стран. То есть как вы видите личности людей или одного человека?
Да, да, сказал бы. So I would argue, I've actually thought quite a bit about this living in Russia over the last couple of years, why I cannot pinpoint a particular reform in Russia, at least in the areas that I know about, the financial, economic... But before going to virtual, I would say why, in my mind, we're currently missing reformers, both in Russia and more generally across the bloc. It's not a Russia-specific phenomenon. And I think it's because of what I suggested. Somehow politics has turned around, not just in Russia, in most countries in our region. And basically to be a reformer, I'll describe now what a reform is not in fashion. So even if we had virtually this kind of characteristics of a reformer, he or she or that team is not going to be a very popular team. So it's not clear how they're going to get to power and do the reforms. So I think this is an issue, certainly in Russia. It's an issue in Ukraine as well. You know, we discuss now a lot how Ukraine is changing and how the economy is changing and so on. I follow quite closely the changes that are taking place, but there are no reformers in Ukraine either, when supposedly is the great period of need of economic reformers. So what is the virtual reformer, what should he or she be like? One, they should have a particular ideology in mind. Most politicians don't have ideology in mind. They come so that people like them, and they by and large try to do things so people like them even more, or at least don't hate them, so that they can get re-elected. So the idea of actually doing something, most politicians ideally wouldn't do anything. Basically, would just take pictures with small kids and, you know, open new factories and, you know, go to meet each other. They wouldn't do anything. So very few politicians that we know around the world in different countries in different periods have come to the government with an idea that I want to do a pension reform, I want to liberalize prices, I want to do something specific. Most of the time it's because the economy or particular sector is in such terrible shape that somebody like that is needed, so the time basically necessitates this. But you first have to have an ideology of coming and doing something. It's not necessarily in my mind that you know how to do it. You can always bring people around you, experts, who can tell you how to do it if you believe them. But you need to generally say, I want to go in this direction. I think such people have existed here and there. They probably do exist in Russia even now. The second part is very, very limited. I think it's zero in Russia now, and it's very limited in the world. You need to be prepared to do the reforms and be ready never to be politician again, basically to think that after that everybody's going to hate you at least for a long period of time. So you'll be doing something different. You're not going to be immediately appreciated for what you've done. And I think that's incidentally why people like Balcerovich, like Klaus, did things relatively early on, which they would have never done. I know both of them quite well. They would have never done the same things 10 years later. You know, basically they were ideologically had a particular view how to do things. They had a great opportunity and they just did it. They didn't think of, would I then remain in power? Would I have a political party? What's my political future? They just did it. Now it's very hard to find people who sort of say, I want to go change this, and then I go back to academia or I go to private business or I do something else. Most politicians think, okay, if I do this, am I going to be liked? And chances are no, you're not going to be liked, and therefore nobody wants to do anything. And incidentally, this is what surprised me a lot in discussions on reform in Russia, at least over the last 2 years. I know a lot of the policymakers in Russia, and when we go to conferences, they say exactly the right things, that you know, these are the types of reformers that you'd be proud to work with and to do things, but then they don't happen. And I think they don't happen because there is no political market for reformers. Even if you had the chance to do it, it's not going to be good for you, so better not. So kamikaze, the second one is you need to be a kamikaze. You go, you do it, and whatever happens, happens. There were such reformers early on in Russia, but not now.
Здравствуйте, меня зовут Станислав Скиля, аспирант МФТИ. У меня такой скучный, немного технический вопрос касаемо линейной аппроксимации, которая у вас была на слайде указана. Скажите мне критерии достоверности, пожалуйста, вашей линейной аппроксимации. Так, ради интереса.
Я не хорошо услышал. Критерии чего?
Критерии достоверности. Ну, когда проводят какую-то аппроксимацию, выдвигается гипотеза, да, я так понимаю? Мне подсказывают критерии верификации, может быть. То есть, когда выдвигают какую-то гипотезу и строят, например, линейную аппроксимацию, считают математические статистики критерии, например, хи квадрат.
Здесь то, что я показал, или
да,
в принципе?
Да, то, что вы показали на слайдах.
Okay. So this is standard regression analysis that adjusts for, so it's basically we are running happiness on income per capita, and then we include various indicators as control variables of, you know, Bulgaria has more days of sunshine than Croatia, that has more days of sunshine than Estonia, and so on. So we control for various things, and then we have a variable, let's say one if you're in this part of the world, in the post-communist world, and zero if you are in the rest of the world, if you're Germany or Austria or Chile and so on. And we're interested in the regressions that I was showing you, we're interested to find out, after we control for all these economic or social indicators, what remains. If you don't have the socialist, post-socialist countries, nothing remains. So basically, there is no remain, no gap. But for the socialist countries, there remains a very large coefficient. Here you saw the coefficient, which is basically the unexplanatory commonality between and among our countries, which is different from the countries in the rest of the world. I'm probably not answering your question, but I'm not quite sure what your question is. So it's very simple regression analysis, and because we have many countries and many years, it's a panel, so it's not just one cut. It's basically 15 years times about 80 countries.
Семен, я должен признаться, что вопрос про линейную аппроксимацию в этой аудитории задается впервые. Вот. И, ну,
просто... Maybe I'll answer it later once I understand the approximation.
А переходя к этой половине зала, не могу держаться от следующего вопроса. Воспринимаете ли вы doing business как свое детище, или вы как-то его уже, так сказать, от себя отделили? И вот если бы вы делали этот рынок сейчас, что бы вы в нем сделали иначе? Условно говоря, часто возникает ощущение, что та или иная страна улучшает свои позиции в рейтинге, при этом в реальности условия ведения бизнеса в ней, ну, либо остаются теми же, либо даже ухудшаются. И наоборот, не сделали бы вы ли сейчас какой-нибудь индикатор, ну, если бы можно было его начать с нуля, да, который бы, например, показывал уровень конкурентности в экономике, степень вмешательства государства не как регулятора, а как экономического субъекта, то есть госкомпании, госкорпорации, насколько высокую долю они занимают. Не сделали бы вы какой-нибудь индикатор, показывающий восприятие бизнесом коррупции, да, сейчас же тоже этого joint business нету, или с вашей точки зрения он как бы оптимален в нынешнем виде и ничего с ним толком делать и не надо?
So the first question, I very much think of myself as the founder of doing business, and I continue to follow what's happening with the indicator. In fact, in one of the upcoming issues of the Journal of Economic Perspective, I have a big article on this topic of how doing business started and how it can be improved over time. So certainly feel still quite engaged. Like anything that you start, there are many things that you can improve. So in this article, perhaps we can present it in another seminar, I've described some of the missing indicators. Not just improvement of current indicators, but missing indicators. And one of the major parts that is missing is indeed what we discussed, some way to get at corruption, because it's clear, not just from what I described here, although this is, I think, very significant, very significant evidence to suggest we should learn a lot more about corruption, because it's not just what we thought, that, you know, if there is corruption, so you lose some economic value, basically, and you're less efficient. But it turns out that corruption is one of the main indicators explaining why people are unhappy, which, okay, maybe we would have known at some level, but they'll be so less happy than the rest of the world, you know. East Europeans are half as happy as West Europeans, to give you the difference. So basically, corruption is explained, and corruption seems to be explaining about 60% of that difference. So we need to learn a lot more about it. You probably don't know that, but even while I was at the World Bank, we had suggested indicators of corruption to include in doing business, and the board of the World Bank refused to consider them, led by the French and the Chinese. The Russian executive director at the time actually voted to include them. And since then, every now and then, we have tried to include some measures of corruption in public procurement, for example, and the board of the World Bank has never let it happen, and will never let it happen.
Очень интересно. Это, мне кажется, что это нигде не было известно до сих пор, эти подробности.
Good evening, thank you for your lecture. My name is Polina. I work on the reform of business inspection currently here in Moscow with all those reforms you have previously mentioned. That is why almost everything that you said is not new to me. Thus, I have two questions. First one is about economic growth and economic models. As an economist, you tend to think in terms of economic models and economic growth, while, for example, I'm not an economist, that's why I would rather think about some social commodities and social models. Many times today you have mentioned the case of Ireland, which is not doing great in terms of economy, but is doing great in all other terms. This summer I hitchhiked all over the country and I have clearly stated that it's the happiest people on the planet, even though there is no sun. The weather is really bad and they are really poor. I would say people in Moscow are much have a higher income than those in Ireland, which make me think about the prospect of this notion of economic growth. Do we really need it? And then you also told us that for our leaders in our part of the world, they see to Asia, bad model. They look at European Union, bad models. Like personally, me, I would think that European or Western model is still better because it was stable for a long time and it brought social stability and progressed in terms of social commodities for people. So I would ask you to comment on this. How crucial is to think in terms of economic growth and what it has to do with the social model? And my second question. My second question is about Eurasian integration. Do you think that there is any economical benefits for Russia, or there's only political benefits for our elites, cronies, and powers? Thank
you. I'll start with the second question because it's easier. I think any growth of an economic space is a good idea, especially economic space, which in the past actually was a single market, not just these five countries, but all of the Soviet Union. In the not so distant past was one large economic space. Now, the start of the Eurasian Economic Union with five countries originally, I think is good for all of the countries that belong to it, probably for the smaller countries more, because they have access to a much bigger market. For Russia, I think, I hope, it's helpful in one specific way that many people do not realize yet, and which the lady who asked the first question attributed to, is that if you look at the countries in the current, at least, Eurasian Economic Union, and who currently is trying to do some reforms, it's not Russia actually, it's mostly Kazakhstan, and to some extent Belarus. For different reasons, I think Belarus, as I mentioned, is very dependent on Russia. They realize that this dependence is not so stable and not so good, so they want to develop some other competitiveness and they look for improving the business environment. For Kazakhstan, as I understand it, it's more a measure of diversification, but they have some strong sectors like energy, for example, but they would like to diversify and have other sectors as well. So the way that I see currently the Eurasian Economic Union is that through it you can push for some reforms, including in Russia, which would not happen otherwise, because as we discussed before, there are no Russian reformers, but they currently at least there are some Kazakh reformers, so maybe there can be some level of getting infected by reforms from the smaller countries. It has happened already in some areas. In this case, this is a positive spillover. Maybe calling it infection is not a good idea. Is thinking in terms of economic growth the right thing? Well, at some level, it is, because as I mentioned in previous studies of happiness, your income per capita comes as number one. So, many things explain how happy you are, but generally the richer you are, within reason of course, the happier you are. So it has to be the case that if you can come up with the types of economic reforms that make the average, not just some people richer, but the average person richer in the country, that should bring happiness happiness up. But as I also mentioned, it's not the only indicator. So I mentioned four indicators, there are others probably, but four indicators: income per capita, health actually is the number one, I should have mentioned. Health is number one, income per capita, weather, roughly speaking, family and weather come roughly with the same weight. So if you ask the question slightly differently, is economic growth modeling the most important thing we should consider, then I would say no. The most important thing to consider is how to make people healthier, because if we manage to make people healthier, then we're all going to be happier, more than if we make them comparatively richer. But then we get into this discussion, how do people get healthy? So if you have a better healthcare system, you certainly are happier, healthier. But there are other things that matter. So I don't know, I've also gone to Ireland and I don't understand why some of these people are happy, because you mentioned the bad weather and you didn't mention the bad food. They also have terrible food. But they're still happy, so there's something to it. Maybe it's family, maybe some indicator that we economists are too naive to capture yet. So is economic growth the most important thing? No, there are more important things. But it is part of what makes societies work better and what makes societies happier. We generally would like to be happier.
Спасибо.
Артем Гетц, вопрос про рейтинги и про их использование в российской практике. Хотел бы, допустим, упомянуть, мы уже говорили про Doing Business, который российские чиновники используют как некую меру качества климата. Да? И вот сейчас активно еще у нас используются рейтинги университетов, чиновники из образования и руководством вузов. Насколько вот эти рейтинги, когда вот они построены, допустим, да, мне как бы сделали измерения, возможно, до момента, говорят, давайте мы поднимемся в этом рейтинге. Мы хотим там, хотим улучшить климат, а для того, чтобы улучшить, давайте будем подниматься в рейтинге. Соответственно, начинаются некие подгон показателей, вот именно те, которые в рейтинге участвуют. То есть, в общем-то, вопрос, действительно ли климат улучшается, или, соответственно, просто подгон для того, чтобы быть выше в рейтинге. То же самое, в общем-то, сейчас по впечатлениям личным и с вузами происходит, да, когда там пытаются и образование подтянуть. И, в общем-то, складывается впечатление, что эти действия, они не очень сильно коррелируют с повышением эффективности университета. Вот как вот эта проблема, как вы ее видите?
How to start answering this? So in science, not just in making indicators, there is this principle called the Heisenberg principle, you probably know of it, which is that the moment you know you're watched, you change your behavior. And it's certainly true of ratings. So the moment that people know that they are rated, they start first adjusting to the rating, but also trying to do things that would improve this particular rating, but may not improve the overall business environment, because every rating has a methodology behind it. And you know, every reasonable person can read this methodology, figure out how the rating is constructed, and as you said, chinovniki can figure out, we're going to change this thing, and we're going to pass a new law or create a new agency and change this particular part of the business environment. Probably that improves something small, but as we discussed, if the overall environment is one of monopolies in sectors, more state control than in the past, corruption, then whether you can start a new business in 7 days or 3 days is actually not that important really. But our index, the Doing Business Index, cannot adjust for that because, as we've discussed, it doesn't have a measure of corruption in it. So, to answer directly your question, it is true that every rating after it's created also creates an industry of trying to fix things on this rating, not taking into account perhaps the overall environment. It's not everywhere like that. So there are some countries that take ratings quite seriously and say, well, we do badly here, so we need to improve. The Netherlands, for example, Sweden, I've worked myself. Initially did quite badly on the business rating, and actually have done significant reforms to improve. Kazakhstan is actually another country that I'll put in this category, but initially was very upset with the rating role. Letters to the World Bank, who are these idiots writing about us, they don't know about anything, they've never been to Kazakhstan. I've been many times to Kazakhstan and so on. But eventually figure out that, you know, it's not going to work like that, so let's start reforming. So as a scientist, I take ratings as an initial approximation of what we've learned about this part of the economy. And then the next question, which the moderator asked, is what else do you need to do? So when I used to work on the doing business team or to lead the doing business team, when I go to a country, I would say, don't just change the environment of starting a business, or don't just change contract enforcement. Try to think of, if you're the business and you go somewhere and you have these difficulties, do you need them? Does the government actually need some of the regulations, laws, and administration that is required of businesses? Most of the time, no. I'll give you, I'm taking a bit more time. I've been very annoyed, and every time I meet a Russian government official, I tell him or her this thing, that in the European Union, when you enter or exit a country, you know, it's an electronic system, so you don't get stamps. In the US, you get a stamp when you enter, but not when you exit. They don't care where you're going, you know, you exit. But in Russia, in a good sort of apparatchik way, you get a stamp both when you enter and when you exit, and it wastes a lot of pages of your passport. So I travel a lot and I get one, another. So I've argued with all kinds of ministers going to the top of your government, just give one. You don't need the other. You have the electronic system as well, both on entry and on exit. And somehow this simple idea that you don't need two stamps hasn't yet permeated the minds of policy makers. That, I cause, if that's removed, it's going to make my life a lot easier and other lives a lot easier as well. And this is a good indicator. It's going to improve slightly, but if you remove this one stamp, or both stamps ideally, it would be faster, you would waste a lot less paper. That's what the type of indicators that I mentioned are useful for. They are not useful for large transformational change. For that, indicators would not help. You need something big. That's why the university indicators are equally limited. So they can give you some suggestion of where universities are, although the indicators, since I'm also a rector of a new university, some of the indicators are really idiotic. Like, to give you an example, whether you own your own building, so the new economic school, which is quite a good school in my mind, gets rated very poorly because we rent, we don't own our building. And because we don't own our building, we are rated significantly lower in the indicators. Stupid.
Друзья, у нас очень хорошие вопросы сегодня и очень интересные ответы. Жалко останавливать, но осталось меньше 5 минут у нас в этом зале, поэтому сейчас все вопросы задаем подряд в режиме блиц и короткий ответ.
Симеон, спасибо за интересную лекцию и откровенные ответы на вопросы. Я представляю одну из достаточно энергетических компаний, экономист. У меня вопрос к вам как, скажем так, скорее не только экономист, но и европеец. Как вы оцениваете вот ваше мнение, ваше отношение к политике Европы, прежде всего, да, в широком смысле к России, к отношениям с Россией, и причем не последний там год-два, да, а вот там, скажем, 10-15 лет. Складывается ощущение, что Европа в некотором смысле не готова на какие-то вот широкие жесты. То есть она только, как бы сказать, любые уступки, в обмен на уступки со стороны России, нет какого-то желания сближаться по-настоящему. Спасибо.
Где же благотворительность?
Вопрос. Здрасте, спасибо за лекцию. Я из динамично развивающегося Казахстана, меня зовут Диас. Я хотел спросить, сейчас к украинским реформам присоединилась команда грузинских реформаторов. Я хотел бы сказать, насколько идентична ситуация, то есть как грузинские реформы могут, хороши ли они достаточно для Украины? И второй вопрос, как улучшить академическую среду в России, будущее экономики в плане кадров, в плане человеческого капитала? Спасибо.
Спасибо. И самый последний.
Максим Никитич, Семен, поскольку вы были министром финансов и вице-премьером Болгарии долгое время, насколько я знаю, хочу спросить вас про вашу родную страну. Все-таки почему после вступления, сначала вот, когда Болгария вступила в ЕС, вроде такие были надежды у всех болгар, почему все-таки потом все получилось не так, и сейчас многие болгары очень обижены на Европейский Союз. Вот о вашей родной стране немного.
Добрый вечер, спасибо за лекцию. Я из РУДН, аспирант. У меня вопрос про образовательные реформы на постсоветском пространстве. Проводились ли такие исследования? И если не проводились, то что, по вашему мнению, какие аспекты должны включаться в это исследование?
Okay. Two questions about academic reform, perhaps, related, and I'll take this last. So Europe's view towards Russia, not just after Crimea, but more generally the last, let's say, 10-15 years, is one of not understanding Russia, but also being afraid of Russia, and that's why not wanting to understand it. Because sometimes you don't understand something, but then you say, well, I better learn more about it so that I know how to act. As was mentioned, I was for 4 years Deputy Prime Minister and Minister of Finance of Bulgaria, and since this coincided exactly with the Eurozone crisis, I spent for a period of time, 2010, 2011, 2012, I spent almost as much time in Brussels as I spent in Sofia trying to deal with European, mostly economic, financial matters. So I met many of the top European politicians on these issues, and we had discussions on other issues like Russia. And perhaps this is the direction of your question, as I understand it, that there is a misunderstanding of Russia, and perhaps not wanting to communicate with Russia, to engage with Russia, if I understand it. In my view, it's exactly like that. So there is both a misunderstanding of what Russia is about, but also to some extent being afraid of learning more, and to some extent constantly being what in the US you call behind the ball, constantly being behind where the action is. So I think a big part of why Europe hasn't been more active and more engaged with Russia is that it constantly has crises of its own. That shouldn't be a big crisis, but somehow become big crisis. Why? Because Europeans are not still one political system, so European institutions are actually very, very young and very inexperienced, very naive. Even a question, you know, in the last 2 or 3 years I'm part of this discussion, there is this very quintessential discussion of who actually is the head of Europe. So, you know, if you need to call one person and tell him or her, you know, there's a problem, who do you call? And actually you don't know, because, you know, there are several presidents of parliament, of the council, of the commission. Some countries like Germany still dominate the discussion. So basically there isn't even a unified political body. And if there isn't a unified political body, decision making is very slow, very ineffective. We've seen this with Greece. Relatively trivial from an economic and financial perspective problem has been dragging on for 6 years without resolve. There are other, let's say, historical reasons why Europe so far has chosen not to engage with Russia as much as, in my view, it should. But also there is a reason that outside perhaps people don't see, which is that the European political system, institutions, are still deeply young and deeply ineffective. There's simply no time to think of a bigger plan and who to work with and and so on. I think, incidentally, this is now rapidly changing because of external threats like Syria, like the Middle East more generally, like China, where Russia, in some sense, Europe would like Russia to be together with Europe as an economic space and compete with Asia, compete with America, but they still haven't figured out the way to do it. I think they will. But it takes slower than we would have thought. Since we're on European topics, Bulgaria, and why are Bulgarians not as happy or clearly unhappy after entering into the EU? Partly for some of the reasons that I mentioned, but when we're entering the European Union, it was thought that, you know, very rapidly would become like the average Europeans. And Bulgaria looks toward Germany and Austria for average Europeans, so we'll be like Austria basically in no time. And then it turned out we are nothing like Austria, and more importantly, we're not even converging towards Austria. So if you look at the early years, which coincided with growth in the whole world, Bulgaria's income per capita was actually converging to European averages. Now it's actually not. In the last three or so years, we're diverging. Europe is on average growing faster than Bulgaria. So people suddenly realize the fact that you're in the Union itself doesn't give you anything. It in fact gives you a lot of responsibilities, but it doesn't give you economic growth, and it doesn't give you social development unless you move. So somebody mentioned that what you could do, and many Bulgarians like Estonians have moved. So our colleague mentioned that about 25%, if I remember, of Estonians have moved. Well, about 20% of Bulgarians live outside of Bulgaria in other European countries, basically because they're not happy with the level of economic and social change in Bulgaria. I think what none of us realize, not the European politicians, not the Bulgarian politicians, is that entering the Union gives you the possibility of a larger space, economic, social, political space. But it also makes it a lot easier for people who are mobile to say, Bulgaria is not going to reform very fast. Let's go to Germany, let's go to London, let's go to Sweden. And by doing this, ironically, entry into the European Union allows you to lose a lot of your brightest and best and most energetic people and further retard your own economic development, which is true of Bulgaria, it's probably true of Estonia, but it's actually true of many other countries, Slovakia, Poland, and so on. So the expectations, as you suggest, clearly were not met. Two other answers before I finish. Georgians in the Ukrainian government. There are quite a few Georgians in the Ukrainian government, as well as a Minister of Economy who is Lithuanian, and is probably the biggest reformer of all in Ukraine presently. So what they did do, to some extent, is try to import reformers. The Georgians, I should note, are in agriculture and judicial reform in the general prosecutor's office as well, so more on the law and order side. The Lithuanian Minister of Economy is the main person doing economic reform. And the Minister of Finance, while ethnically Ukrainian, actually was born in Chicago and lived in the US for a very long time. So far, these people have been actually the only people who have tried to do anything reasonable in terms of reform. I think perhaps because of the answer to the question that the other colleague mentioned. Because they know they don't have a political future in Ukraine. They know that they're there for a year, maybe a year and a half, and then they leave. They're not going to be part of the Ukrainian political elite. So for that reason, they're not afraid to actually push for reforms. Some of them are successful, some of them are not successful, because once they get to parliament, parliament looks at them and says, well, who are you to tell me what to do in my country? So there is this attitude of, you know, there is no way we're going to listen to Georgians to tell us what to do in Ukraine. So many of the reform initiatives, which in themselves are quite good, basically get bogged down in parliament. But still, these are the people who at least are trying to do something. If you look at the rest of the government, basically nothing is happening, and people are realizing this, not just economists. And last answer, I'll not be able to answer it in great detail, on academic reform in academic reform in Russia. Being part of the university system in Russia, although in a relatively small way, the new economic school is a private university, so we don't have to deal with a lot of the bureaucracy and administration that relates to the rest of the universities. I see many things that can be improved, primarily at the university level. So the higher education system, there are things to improve, but generally it still produces, relative to average European values, in my mind, quite good students. The problem happens when you get to university. Basically, and I've told my students frankly, I insult some people that don't go to many of the other economics faculties around Russia, because you end up being worse than when you entered. It's actually is a net, net negative going through university in Russia, on, at least on economics, probably on other sciences it's significantly better. Because somehow the textbooks have changed and the lectures have changed, but the thinking is the old Soviet, or however I can call it, thinking of what economics is about. Namely, that economics is basically a sort of a very strict, focused, precise science. And it's not, it's a social science. So we try to understand what people do, how they behave, what they think, and from that, hopefully, to understand some economic phenomena. But there are many other problems that I can discuss in academic work here, but at least in economics, for me, the main issue is that the current professors, teachers, and so on in the Russian academic space think of economics as an exact science, and it's not. And if you teach it as an exact science, you end up basically teaching rubbish. Better not to to do it at all.
Спасибо огромное, Семен. Очень интересная лекция, совершенно блестящий ответ на вопросы. Давайте поблагодарим.